we have a speaker, Shashank Aryan, with us. So first introduce yourself.
Hi guys, I'm Shashank. I write softwares for Nika display network, especially. I mostly code in Python and JavaScript, sometimes related technologies also. Today we are going to see how concurrency works. So it is a 101 talk. We will be talking about the foundations, the basic things that goes underneath. So starting, I already told about myself. So here we will be covering in this talk concurrency, the characters that play the role in concurrency, which is thread, task and process. How to use concurrency, we will see two set of problems. One is IO bound process, and second we will see CPU bound process. And then we will come to a conclusion that when to use concurrency and what set of libraries should be applied to a specific problem. So this talk is not including any specificity about any library. We are talking on very foundation layer, okay? So starting it, so what is concurrency? So if we see a very dictionary meaning of it, is something which is occurring simultaneously. Okay, so it is something that at the same time multiple things are going on. So the major thing which plays the role is thread, task and process. So on the top of the layer, on the high level, these all three things are very same. They are set of instructions which are going to be followed in an order. Okay, but if we deep down into the details, we will see that all these three are slightly different in terms of their execution. How we are going to leverage that, how it is executing, we can leverage that part and use on the basis of our use case. Okay, so talking about thread, so when we start with a thread, we generally talking about a set of instruction which is going to be executed. Now the main thing which comes into play is when we apply threading, the OS knows about the what are the multiple threads going on, and they can preempt them. So here we will be using mostly preemptive multitasking, which means the OS can take the control back from a execution. It can happen in a single Python statement like x is equal to x plus 1, and it can do at the end of us at end of a several statement. So the OS is in the control of taking the control from the particular thread. Coming to task, so task is generally we talk about in terms of async IO. Task multiple tasks run, but the main point that or benefit you can say with the task is the task have the control to leave the execution, and they can stand out and say now I'm ready to wait, and some other task can come and start its execution. Coming to process, so process is something which is actually going to run simultaneously. Okay, why I'm talking before explaining concurrency and parallelism, because we need to understand how these things are working on the cores of our CPU. So if we talk about thread and task, these are working on the single core of our CPU, but in the case of processes, they are going to run on multiple processors which are out there in our system. So so how, if they are working on the single processor, how we can call it concurrency? We can call it concurrency still, because the multiple tasks are cleverly taking turns and speeding up the whole process. Okay, so in the case of threads, it is the OS who is switching the task, but in the case of the threads, OS is taking and giving turns to different threads. But in the case of tasks, multiple tasks are raising out and saying that now I'm ready to wait, and now we can some other task can come and work in the process. So concurrency, so parallelism, again working in parallelly on different set of processors that we have. Going ahead, how to use concurrency. So we have two set of problems in which concurrency applies and works better. So the first use case is IO bound process. So what is IO bound process? IO bound process is something in which the actual computation is very less time and most of the time is spent on waiting for some other slow devices, which is slower than our CPU, like a network connection or a device, let's say we can interact with a hard drive or a printer, something like that, in which there is some interaction with some external device which is comparatively slower than the CPU. So here we can see that the blue boxes are the time in which actual computation is going on, and the red boxes are the times in which there is a waiting period. So we can see there is very less time of computation and more time is getting expense for the waiting for IO interactions. Okay, so now I'll be showing you, basically we will start with a synchronous version. So a program I took as an example is making requests and fetching those URLs and just reading them. Okay, and let's see how much time each of the version takes. So we will be seeing synchronous version, then we will see the threading version of it, then we will see the async IO version, and then we will come to the multiprocessing and see how all of these work in this set of problem when we are going to interact with any set of IO program. Okay. So walking through the code for just some time. So here what we are doing, we are generating we are using a request library for the getting the URL. We are reading all the sites. So I have picked two sites, python.org and PyDelhi.org, multiplied it with 25. So we have a 50 list in the list. We have a 50 URLs to fetch and read. Okay. And the read site length is doing nothing. It is just reading and it is printing that I read from this site. Okay. And read all site is where the session object from request we are picking, and we are just binding that particular with our URL and the session. Okay. So let's just run this. So it has started reading in the synchronous manner. We will see that time, how much time it is going to take. So meanwhile it is executing. Let me tell you the what is the best part of it and what is the drawback. Why shouldn't we use the concurrent version? The best part is it is very easy to write. It is very easy to manipulate, to debug, to control, have a control over the entire process. But if so it took 22 seconds. But the trade-off is, the problem with this program setup execution is we are taking a lot of time for the execution, because most of our time is going to spend in the waiting period for different set of URLs. Okay, so coming to the threading version, here we are using a threading library to generate a local session of thread. Okay, we are using a thread pool executor. So here the thread pool executor, let's understand that thread, you already know what is a thread pool. It is a collection of thread, and the executor is the part which is handling all the threading stuff. That means the OS is going to preempt the particular thread and put some other thread into the action. Okay, so here we are creating, at this point we are creating a local session of the thread. Okay, in this part we are getting a new session. Here there is a problem that the request session is not thread safe, so the resources might get intermittent bugs due to the sharing of resources. So that is why we are creating a separate session for each of our threads. Here we are doing a similar stuff that we were doing in the synchronous version. We are reading a site, getting the new session, we are reading the site. Here, after that, what thread pool executor is doing, it is launching some workers. Like we will talk about how I decided four workers to be there as an executor, and we are just using the map function to map our executing function with the list of the sites. Let's execute it. So So we will see, it is reading but at a much faster rate than the synchronous version. And we hit this point at 6.81 seconds. Earlier we took 22 seconds to fetch the same set of sites. So now we can directly see that it is improving. Now why it is improving? Because multiple threads are launching at the same time and they are executing on the same processor, same core of processor. So here synchronous version, as I told you, it is launching the request. It is now the yellow is the waiting time and response is generated for request 2. Again it is sending, the yellow time is the waiting period and the response is then thrown out and respectively for the third. If you see the threading version, what is happening for the multiple threads, the request is being sent and we have an overlapping time which is a savior for us in this case. That is why we are reducing the entire overall process and speeding up the execution. Okay. So this is the view how our tasks and multiple threads are taking turns. And here the CPU is in the control of switching them out. Okay. Now coming back to the async IO version, we are using here. First of all, let's talk about why that threading version is rocking for us, because it is saving time. Okay. But on the same time, it is coming with a sort of complexity because we have to write the code in a bit complex manner than the synchronous version. And at the same time, writing that complex means the debugging is going to be a complex process. If something, because this is a very small use case, so it looks very fine. But if we are working on a large scale problems, and especially with threading, the scaling is a lot of, it comes with a lot of issue, because when you are going to scale, launching a lot of threads. Let's talk about the max worker part here. Then we can go to the max worker is something we are launching the number of threads. That number of threads. So what happens if we have 50? Why can't we launch 50 threads at the same time and get the things done? This will not work for our case because launching a thread and destroying the thread also takes time. And it is also expensive, so it is also adding that particular time to our execution. So overall process gets delayed. So I have tried multiple times and I have found that 4 to 8 and up to 10 works the best. Other than that, it is something which is experimental and you can try it on your own.
So okay. Is there something like good idea to start in wherever we do, I have 50 tasks, so what would be the number, is there any good point to start or calculate
as far as I have tried with multiple set of numbers, mm-hmm. is 4 to 8 max up to 10 works good for a case when you have 120 or 200 URLs to fetch. Okay. Because you have that set, that list, yeah. to fetch and that number of threads, one thread will be putting a request, then it will be waiting for some time,
yeah.
And at the same time multiple 10 all the 10 threads will be doing the same. Mm-hmm. Once a response is returned, this will launch another request because it has already completed. So the sequence, if we see the graph, we can see that the task two is first taking.
Yeah, I do understand that part very clearly. I'm just asking a relation between the number of tasks and number of threads.
You should just keep in mind that the cost of creating a particular thread and destroying should not make it expensive.
Yeah.
Because the overall goal is to speed up our process. The entire IO bound process, we want to speed it up. So it should not be we optimize this so much that we are again in the same page that our program is getting delayed in the terms of execution. Is that fine?
Yeah.
Okay. So max worker is done. The problem I already told you. Second thing with the problem with this version of code is we have to check for the thread save case. Why? Because the threads are running independently, okay, and they can share the resource which is going to be manipulated by one of the threads, and we can have the intermittent bugs due to that. If something is being used by some other resource and at that time it got changed and it is again going to be used by some other thread, so this is the problem with this version. So this is why we cannot use it much at a scale. Okay, so let's talk about async IO. Async IO is something which came with Python 3.7, it is now the part of it. So first of all, before going to the code, let's talk about what async IO does for us. So we have two new keywords, async and await. So as I said earlier, that the execution and the resting of the control is in the hand of task, that particular task which is. So we have to add some extra complexity and extra code to do that process. So await is there, which does this job. So anything which we have written in async dev or async context, so we can let know other task that await now, the await keyword is used to let know other task that now I am going for a waiting state. Other tasks can come up and take the turns and execute that process. So we will talk about the little comparison between these two versions at the later point in the talk. So let's go with the, this example. Again, we have one more thing which I want to talk. We cannot use like request library because it does not implement async and await things inside. So we have used AIO HTTP. So one more problem with this setup. This is clear now? So one more problem is it is a new set of implementation, and we have to be very selective if this particular library supports async and await methods or not. Basically async generators, if you know, yeah, like a bit more about async IO, these are generators which are working in action. We are not going into that details because it is a like separate topic to talk about. So let's start and see the code. Here we have a session which we are getting from the client session. Okay, so first of all we are starting with read side. In the read side, we are getting a session plus an URL to do the operation. In the read all sides, what we are doing is we are importing a client session from AIO HTTP, and we are keeping a list of tasks in which we are going to put all the particular future threads. Your futures is something what we call inside async IO. So all the tasks into that particular list, and we will we have an event loop. So in async IO, the sequence is you first launch an event loop, you insert the multiple tasks into that event loop, and then await until it gets completed. Okay. So let's run this and see how is the performance. So you can see that it is extremely faster. It did our job in 1.82 seconds. It was way faster. Why it was way faster? Few things I want to point out here. It was faster than async threading version. Why? The major reason is it is working under a single thread. Multiple tasks are launching inside a single thread, and every task is taking turns and giving up the control on their own. So there is no dependency on the OS to get that task particular thread out of the execution or put it back. So the control is here, but at the same time it comes with the cost that what happens, this is a very small case, use case. What happens if we have a case in which a task didn't give up the control? So we have a problem here. So we have to be a little skeptical about writing code, because this is the main flow. If a task is not going to give up the control, the computation and the waiting time is going to be a lot longer, more than, even worse than the synchronous version of our code. Correct. So I hope by this time we are completed with those versions where we can see how on a single core machine, on a single core of our CPU, different tasks are taking turns and speeding up the whole process of execution. Is that fine? So now we can jump into the multiprocessing version of it. So what happens with multiprocessing version is, let's start with the graph. So different Python interpreters are going to launch for different set of cores that our computer has. Okay, and so multiprocessing library does this for us. We do not have to write any extra thing, because till this time we had a GIL in place which which ensures that only one process or one thread is going to be executed at a single point of time. So dividing the particular process into multiple cores is going to speed up the execution by distributing the work over the cores, because we have multiple cores in our CPU as of now and we can leverage that. So multiprocessing does this for us, and you can see that the process is same as synchronous, but we are launching like as many as cores that our machine has. So that is why it is, the speed is going to be uplifted. So let's go through the code. So again, we are back to request, because we do not need any sort of special methods like async AIO. We can work with the request library. Multiprocessing is what we are going to use. We are going to use the pool for of multiprocessing to gather our task. So what we are doing here, we are setting up a global session, because each interpreter is going to have their own set of sessions. That means each process is going to have their own interpreter inside it. Okay. So we are getting the global session. Now inside read side, what we are doing for using that session, we are getting the response. Now what I have done extra is I try to get the name of the process, which is a processor, which is actually working for that particular URL. Okay. Coming to next, we are using, as I said, we are using a pool, initializing it with a global session as a pool, and we are mapping all our list of sites to this pool, and let's see how it is working for our case. So now we can see that 1, 2, 3, since this is a 4-core CPU machine, so we are seeing that multiple processors are taking turns, and the entire list is going to be divided over multiple CPUs, and each CPU is working on their own synchronous manner. So it is parallel. Why? Because it is executing parallelly, but each of the single core is doing the synchronous work. That is why overall it is speeding up our execution. So if you will see, it is like more costly than our last two versions. Why is that? So because the multiprocessing version is written in such a manner that it does fast the computational time. Okay, but in this set of problem, we have a waiting time. And why those two versions were rocking? Because they were overlapping the waiting time. We can see it here that we have an overlapping time in both the cases. Okay, but we do not have the like any kind of these overlapping in this case. We are just distributing all the list over the multiple cores that we are having. So let's see another use case, a CPU bound program, and see how the different methods are going to be helpful in our case. Okay. So here we are picking a simple addition of a long list, so that it adds like some more time for the computation. Okay. And inside a CPU bound program, there is no waiting time, because we are not interacting with any sort of IO stuff. Okay. And we are only computing. So speeding up the execution is the part where we have to think that on the same set of time, we are doing some extra work to speed up the computation at the end of the day. Okay. So let's start with the program, and then we can see. So here what I have done is I have taken like some delta around in the range of 20, and I'm adding it to that particular number. That is a huge number to compute, because I am doing like multiplications and then summation of the, so it will take some time. It will take some of the time. Now I will also show you in this version, we'll check on the system monitor that which of the process is going to use and how it is like speeding up the whole execution. So let's run this, and we will see it here also. So the task is going to run, and you can see, okay, I actually run the multiprocessing version. Let's see that. So you will see all our other CPUs are ideal. Only one CPU is 100% with the usage of 100%. So the entire computation is being done in the single CPU. And the execution is done in the manner of a synchronous, like it will compute for first, then it will compute for second, then so on. Okay, and now it took, we can see it took around 16 seconds here. We can see it took around 16 seconds. Now, if we look into the synchronous version, it has like compute problem 1, as I told earlier, problem 2, and then so on. Let's see how. Now, there is a question, like what will be the result if we apply threading or async IO versions for CPU bound process? Any clue or idea you can think of?
So it will not do any change because the request will fire multiple, but it will use only one core, the CPU.
Yeah, exactly. So, and will it like add some more time into it? Will it delay the process or what?
It will add some more time because the threads, it needs to create those threads and destroy those threads.
Correct.
It will be extra overhead.
Absolutely correct. So, applying our async IO or threading method into CPU bound is not going to help us. Why? Because the waiting time is not there. And in the if we talk about async IO and threading version, these are only doing faster computations. Why? They are reducing and overlapping the waiting time. This is how they are speeding up the whole execution. But we do not have the similar case here in the CPU bound process. So what is the answer? So we can go with the multiprocessing version only. That is why I have not written code in these versions, because these are like little expensive. You can try it out at home. These are like launching threads and destroying threads, launching tasks and destroying them will add additional cost, and it will take like we were computing it in 7 seconds, it will add like 10 seconds. It will increase it like 2-3 seconds will be increased. So let's see our multiprocessing version. In this, we are again using multiprocessing and the pool function of it. So it is the similar summation that we were using in the synchronous version. Now compute sum is launching a pool, and pool, in that pool we are mapping the list of numbers, the whole set of numbers that we are going to do operation on. So let's run the code and see how it is helping us. So we can see the entire CPU strength is 100%, and the execution is still going, and we perform like a better place with 9.33 seconds. And we see how execution was distributed over all the CPUs. We enhance the computation and like reduce the overall execution time. So why this version is great? Because we have a time duration. For the similar time duration, we have more computations. We have parallel computations that is going in place, which is speeding up the overall process. And this is the key thing with the multiprocessing. But there is again a problem, which is like hard to write. The code gets a little bit complex, it is hard to debug, and again it is something like very small use case, and we are not seeing the challenges here at this point of time. But if in the real scenario, in the business problems, you might get a case that you have to be like very skeptical about writing all the codes, and if a bug arises, it is really going to take time more than synchronous version to solve it. So that was the major trade-offs between CPU bound programs, IO bound programs, multiple versions we have seen. So coming back to, so we can see like multiple problems are going to be distributed. Now concluding this talk with when to use concurrency, like when we should decide, because premature, like as you said, launching multiple number, premature optimization is the root of all evils. We are going to pre-optimize everything in the very beginning. It is going to cost us in the end, and it is going to we have to pay more in terms of execution time and to get that particular result. So when to use concurrency? So if your program is literally taking 2 seconds, don't apply concurrency to it. Why I'm telling you 2 seconds? Because 2 seconds is a it is some number which you can think of it as a good execution time, and we can perform things better. If it is a we were fetching multiple URLs, we are doing a huge computation in terms of adding numbers. But if we literally want to apply, we are ready, like we have made up our mind that now we are ready to apply concurrency, we should be very skeptical. Now at this point of time, I think you all can like understand which set of problems and which set of tools you can map and speed up the whole process, because at the end of the day, you want to execute things faster. The intent is to execute things faster. So you should not end up paying more price into it. Okay, writing the complex code is good, but it is going to be effective only in the case when we are getting the value from it, out of it. Okay. One thing I wanted to talk about, like what is the like difference or comparison when we should opt a threading version, when should we opt like async IO version. So we should be like very clear that async IO at this point of time is coming with a like set of limitations with the libraries, because most of the libraries are not moved yet in the async IO format. We are not extensively using async and await methods, the asynchronous generators, which is going to, you know, like in some time situation can come that you might apply the async version and it is going to be broken in, because due to some interdependency of the code, because the other libraries. So you have to be skeptical there, although we see that our performance is best in that case. Still, if we are good, if we see the case that we do not have that set of libraries present over here, so we can still go with the threading version, because it is also helping us with the case. And we just have to ensure that the thread should be, the program should be a thread safe thing. So so that we do not end up going into a state where it is like some intermittent bug and we are not going to like spending more of time in solving that case. And if it is a CPU bound program, it is very clear that you should use multiprocessing. Why? Because multiprocessing only focuses on computation time. It splits all the problem statements and speed up the overall execution time to get the results faster. So that was it. Any questions or discussions or suggestions you might want to add? Yeah, please.
Okay, first of all, congratulations on a wonderful talk. This was the reason I actually came here, because I was confused with concurrency. My first question to you is, can you please shed some light on global interpreter lock and how it does it affect concurrency, or does it even affect it or not?
So GIL, when you talk about it, is a lock. By name, it suggests its intent. Okay. Mm-hmm. So it ensures that at a single point of time, only one thread is getting to be executed. So if we see this sort set of graph, I hope the things will be clear to you. Like we can see that at a single point of time, only a single thread is going to be executed. There is no overlapping, and that is what GIL, the main sole purpose of GIL is that. You can read a lot about it on Google and python.org, but the sole purpose in a nutshell is that it allows only a single thread to work at a single point of time.
Okay.
Was that clear?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the examples that we saw, right? So all these examples, the things we were processing, right? So they were kind of independent of each other.
Mm-hmm.
We are looking at, we are reading URLs.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
So is it that all these methods helps us in parallelization, but may not work that well in when there is dependency between those processes?
So you have to see the case, how much resources are going to be shared. You have to think in that case how it is shared and how it is affecting the execution of other. Because manipulation happens when you are inside a code. There is something on top of it which is going to be manipulated, but it should not affect the execution of the other process that is going to be done or executed. So this is the main goal which we should think priorly before writing any sort set of concurrency, that we should be very clear when to use like that particular tool set and how to execute it, because here the how is very, very important. You should be very skeptical and careful that it does not end up like losing the achieve, like whatever target we are owning or aiming to achieve. So this is the whole thing which I want to add. Next thing, if you are asking if we can apply the particular process in the shared, where something is going to be extensively shared. So if something is going to be extensively shared, so we can either try like for IO, we can try, still we can still go with the multiprocessing version of it, because we are still getting faster results than async IO. And first of all, you have to see that how resources are going to be distributed over all the multiple threads or multiple tasks or multiple processes that we are having. And this is a use case based decision that you will take at that particular time, seeing the scenarios, seeing the variables that you are using, seeing the other characters that you are putting into that program. So this is the wholesome thing which I want to add.
Like when we talk about parallelization, mm-hmm. our goal is to increase the efficiency of whatever resources we have. Right?
Yeah.
So when we talk about concurrency, I'm talking about myself. Like I would think in terms of the processes that we are executing. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So there will be race conditions. There will be dependencies.
Yes, definitely there will be.
So are we saying that Python hasn't reached that stage where we can think in those terms? That library.
Yes, exactly. So the libraries that which is playing, because I told you when we were implementing the async IO part, so we had to deal with the code where the task is going to say, hey, I'm ready to wait, someone else can come up. So here the event loop is managing all the things inside the black box. So it is a black, like starting on the top, this I didn't wanted to talk about the black box, because again a single black box is like a great topic to talk about and it can take time, so I didn't wanted that to focus on there. But yes, the library that we are using here is actually playing the role, because if you see, the multiprocessing is enabling us to display our set of tasks over the multiple processors that we are having. In the async IO case, the event loop is like taking the decisions and managing all these things. If you see the threading part, the threading module, each session, now the OS is executing, yes, OS is executing, but the threading, why did we do the local session? It was only because since the control is in the hand of OS, so there is a chance that something can go bad. There can be a race condition, definitely. That is why we used a local thread and we applied session to all those threads, and each were running individually, having their own context managers. Does that answer your question?
See, we were talking about threading and async IO using one CPU.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And multiprocessing is entirely another thing using multiple CPUs.
Yes, yes.
So do we not have a library which can handle best of both? Means threading.
I got your point. I'm talking about
a scenario wherein mm-hmm. you have a requirement of making a request, then you have a CPU intensive calculation
mm-hmm. yeah.
on the results which come from the request.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I'm fetching some data and performing some.
Yeah, I got your
so
point. Like,
how can I mix these two things
and leverage best out of
it? Multi-processing with a multi-threading on each processor.
Yeah, I got your point.
Something like that there in Python.
So, like till
now, TensorFlow and all, they are using at backend, they are using this thing.
Exactly.
This multi-processing along with
optimization of threads. Yes,
yeah.
Like you said, TensorFlow and other things do that, because
yes.
Like having just the leverage of splitting the task over multiple processes and splitting, like cleverly taking turns is not going to like help a lot in the real use case. So yes, there are libraries which does this process, but till now I have not covered all those parts. Like it is something which I am reading about. It's not, like that part I have not reached, and like I would like to like read this. When I read this, we can talk about it. Any other questions?
Can you suggest some additional resources that we could read upon or? We could
So I will add the resources into the GitHub issue link. You can get it from there. Anything else? So okay, thank you guys. Thank you so much for listening.